Okay, so it's running there now. So I'm just going to screen share a PowerPoint presentation that will take us through the different things that I want to talk about today. And just like last week, the first part of that is going to be about some things that I've come across on the internet that I found inspiring, that made me think, that kept me interested. Okay, so just give me a minute to get this up on the screen. Here we go. Now, so this is the opening. You're going to get this presentation afterwards, so that you can look over it yourself at home with all the notes. So you don't need to take any notes. You can just relax and listen to me talk. We will have a chance, as I said, you'll have a chance to contribute as well. So I often find, to be honest, at a presentation like this, if I go to hear somebody talk and I bring a notebook with me and I try and make notes, it distracts me from actually listening to the content. So if you can, don't worry about taking notes. Just relax. Let it go in. You know, you won't forget anything. And you'll have the notes afterwards to refer back to. So Bealtaine the Festival, as I said, and the sponsors, they're all there. And just some places I found inspiration this week include this Guardian article. I'm just going to stop sharing this for a minute because I've got the web pages open. And I'll share them with you now. Hold on. Oops. Here we go. Share. Okay, so there's a couple of different things that I have found helpful this week. Get them in order. Can you all see that? Yeah. Can you all see what I'm sharing? It's a Guardian article. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I can.
Yeah. Can you see it?
No.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Is there anybody who, Michael, can you see it now?
No, I can't see anything. I'm gone into it. I can see all the screens. That's all I can see.
Do you have it on speaker view, Michael?
I haven't. I don't know what's happening to this screen. I've got a different screen up now. I can't even get gallery view or anything like that.
Let me just stop
maybe,
this.
Maybe I'll go out and come back in again, if that's all right.
Sure. If everybody else can see, you can look these up later on, Michael, if you want to just stay with us.
Okay,
as well.
That's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah, you don't have to see them all now. So what I'm sharing here, I'll describe what I'm sharing for you, okay? So I just see if I can just put this onto full screen. Hang on a second. Because it'll make it a little bit easier for everybody to see it. And a full screen. Okay. I'll take that away. Can you see? So this is an article that I came across in The Guardian. The journalist on the left is, his name is Sean O'Hagan. He's an excellent journalist when it comes to photography. I recommend that you look him up and follow him. He's on Instagram and he's on Twitter, and you will see that he writes for The Guardian quite regularly. He's not as regular as he used to be. But this is an article, the headline is Frontline Hero, the Rocky Mountain GP who healed America, okay? It's not about the specific individual. This is one of the first photo essays. It was done by a photographer whose name is W. Eugene Smith. And it's a seminal photo essay. It was one of the first, one of the strongest. It changed the way photojournalism was done, basically. It's a very famous photo essay. It was commissioned by the GPs Association in America, and it was commissioned to emphasize the lack of or the need for more GPs in rural places in America. I you can read the article yourself. I'm not going to go into all the detail, but I recommend that you read the article and that you look at the pictures. There's a lot of stuff around on the internet about this. About this particular this essay, so I just found this very interesting. I studied it when I was in college. It was one of the essays that was recommended to us in a module that I studied on social documentary. And there's another page here on it on the Magnum website. I've also included a link to that. And then the next thing that I came across this week on the internet is this piece on the Irish Museum for Modern Art. It's a it's an essay by Fiona Loughnane. The title is Image of Reality. Hang on. Image of Reality, Image Not Reality. What is Photography? It takes 14 minutes or thereabouts to read it. And it really will inform a lot of the background or the context to what we're talking about today in terms of contemporary photography. So I also highly recommend it. It doesn't take long to read. It's very well written and it's very informative. And then the last thing, I mentioned this last week. If anybody doesn't know who Martin Parr is, I'll just explain. Martin Parr is also a member of Magnum. Magnum are a photography agency. One of the first photo agencies ever set up by a handful of very famous photojournalists just after the war. So Martin Parr is a member. He's a very controversial photographer. A lot of people feel, I remember talking to one lady about his work, and she expressed the strong feeling that he was mocking people. I don't get that from his work at all. But whether you like his work or not, to me, is not relevant. His work is very relevant to where we are today. And I would recommend that you follow him on Instagram and look him up. When this is over, maybe do a bit of looking around yourself. He has a very famous book called The Last Resort. It's a photo book called The Last Resort. And it was really about the decline of industry in Britain and Britain in the early 80s. His work is mostly concerned with tourism and things like that. Some of his work is very good. Some of it is not very good. But I recommend that you look him up anyway. So I'll just go back now. Does everybody any questions before I move on?
No.
Okay.
No, it's fine.
Are any contributions you want to make? Does anybody know Martin Parr? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I do. I think he's fantastic.
Yeah, I really
like him. But I get why other people interpret him the way they do.
Yeah.
Fine line.
Yeah.
I guess it's up to us as the viewer to judge where we sit on that line.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's interesting. I remember having this conversation, like I was saying, with this woman. I'll just stop sharing so we can talk. And it was a very, for me, it was when I think back on it now, it was a very important conversation. Because she had such a strong, visceral reaction to his work. She felt he was mocking us, and he was mocking people in general. And I don't get that off his work. Some of it I think there is a kind of humor in it, I suppose, that you could describe as mocking. But I really like his work. But it was instructive to me because I suppose as a student of photography, one of the things that that's constantly emphasized is that you should get past the whole idea of like and dislike. You know, that it's not that you can't like and dislike something, but that you have to analyze, if I like this, you have to be able to say why you like it or what is it about it that you like. And if you react so strongly about it, you also have to think about, why do I feel that? I mean, I remember coming across, the name of the work escapes me right now, but several times it's happened where I had quite a visceral dislike of something. But I found my reaction to it when I analyzed the reaction was really interesting, you know, that, yeah. So that's something I would recommend to you all as people who are interested in photography, that you try and move past just the simple like and dislike, because it's almost too easy to just dismiss a piece of work because you don't like it. Okay? With me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes. So I'm just going to go back to sharing the presentation again, and if I can find it. Yeah, here. Okay. So can you all see this now?
Yeah.
Okay. Let me just go into full screen. if I can find it, enter full screen, yeah. Okay, so this is last week's assignment. Just for those of you who weren't there, if you weren't there last week, you will get the notes from last week as well as this week and the first week as well. So last week's assignment, we talked about home last week, again, which is a subject that is easily accessible to everybody during the times that we live in. It's also, you know, if you're a writer, if you ever hear writers talking about their work, they will often recommend that you write about what you know. So it's the same, if you want to become a photographer and use images as a language, you should make work about what you know. And that's what is recommended, and that's certainly, in my experience, what I would recommend. So last week's assignment was to make a photograph or a series of photographs that tell your story. Some things to consider. Think about what you include in the frame and also what you deliberately exclude. So we talked last week about show, don't tell, about withholding information, making the viewer have to think, if you like, about what they were being shown and what story was going on in this image. Review the images presented here. So that's the images in last week's presentation. Introduce your characters and their relationship to each other. Experiment, play, make mistakes, but most of all, have fun. So we have a couple of contributions based on that assignment, and I'll share them now. So first one is Michael. Is he here? Michael, are you here?
Yep.
Okay. Michael, you actually submitted four images. So I put them in like a mini slideshow. I'll just show everybody. And if anybody would like to comment on Michael's work, please feel free to comment. Obviously, we keep it constructive. Feedback should be constructive. It doesn't necessarily have to be that you like it or you dislike it. But like I said, if you like or dislike it, then you should be able to say why you like it and so on. So here's Michael's four images, I think. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Does anybody have any, would you like to see it again before we comment on it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, one more time. Okay. Would anybody like to, or will I start the feedback?
I was thinking that they're all interconnected in a way that they're all in, they seem to be based in his garden, which would indicate that that's somewhere nice and special maybe for him. Mm. And the moon is part of nature and the garden is part of nature. There's a little angel here. But they all seem to be interconnected in some way, because the angel appears, the moon appears twice, I think, and the angel ornament appears.
Yeah.
And they're all set in nature. Yeah.
Thanks, Heather. That's a nice piece of feedback. And I should emphasize as well that there's no right or wrong answer to this. You should be thinking about what your response is. So somebody on here might have a completely different response to Michael's images. Michael, you can say a few words in a minute, but I'll just let it go around the people here first. I will say one thing. Sorry, did somebody else want to comment there?
I like that he got a bird in the first shot. Yeah, my eye was drawn to the bird.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
First into the moon, but then to the bird.
Yeah, the bird.
And I was just going to say, I find those images very contemplative. And they're kind of quiet. They're still. They're very still and contemplative.
Yeah. Yeah. I think they're very relevant to the times we're going through at the moment. We have a lot of time, as you said, Tara, to contemplate and stamp something that I'm hoping we'll be talking about today. We have a lot of time to look. We can use the time constructively.
Mm-hmm.
I really like this one. I like them all, but I really like this one. There's something about it. It's like I was saying last week, Michael, it's like the opening image in a story. It makes me think, and I don't mean this in a negative way, it makes me think of a graveyard. You know, one of those old overgrown graveyards that you want to look around and have a route around? I really like it. I like them all. I love the moon. Anybody else?
Is that a tree that's used or similar to the trees that are used in graveyards?
Yes. Yes. Was there somebody else there?
Yeah. Can I ask Michael?
Go ahead, Pascal.
Yeah.
I think Pascal's connection is frozen. Yeah.
Can I ask Michael something?
Yeah, go ahead, Pascal. Please do.
Yeah, I'm wondering if the little statue is always there, or did he put it there for the photo?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Say that again.
Did he put the statue there for the photo shot, or is it always there?
It's always there.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, the story behind that statue is a neighbor of mine, long ago deceased, you gave me a present of that statue. And every time she wanted me to do the garden, or the garden was getting a bit unruly, she moved the statue into a different place. Mm. I was widowed at the time, and she moved the statue into a different place whenever she wanted me to do something.
Okay, very nice.
It was a message.
Yeah, it was a good story.
Can I just comment on these two? This one, Michael, I have a photographer that you should look at. His name is Todd Hido. Todd Hido, yeah. He's California. And this reminds me of his work. He has photographed a lot of neighborhoods, a lot of houses at night. And his work is really beautiful and really evocative. And this really reminds me of his work. Last week we looked at Larry Sultan?
Yeah.
Todd Hido was a pupil of Larry Sultan's.
That was the night of the blood moon there a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
And I hadn't got a longer lens. So I banged away. That's outside my house.
Yeah.
So I went from the back and then I went into the front and got a range of photographs there. But that was probably the best shot of them all, you know, other than the other one.
It also reminds me, there's a guy I studied with, Rob Briscoe, I think is his name, and he did a whole series of walking at night. And actually, there's a lot of cultural references, cultural theory, if you like, and art that has been made about night, you know, that time that we're supposed to be asleep and because we're supposed to get up and be productive during the day. It's a really rich subject to explore with a camera or whatever other media. So and I thought this was interesting too. You just got enough out of focus in the background there to draw my interest to wonder what you're trying to say with this one.
That, again, I took the outside of the house, the garden, as a subject, mainly, you know.
Yeah.
And that's the outside of my house. And I took it as the theme was what we're all experiencing now, really, you know.
Yeah.
The theme was the spring coming, things are going to change anyway.
Yeah, hope. So before I move on, does anybody else want to contribute anything?
I love the two nighttime photos. I love the atmospheric quality that they have.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, there's something very haunting and yet very beautiful about them. You know, they're full of atmosphere.
And I would agree. And just add that the first one with the branches, the tree branches going diagonally across the screen. So that to me is like a painting.
Yeah, this one. Yeah. I love the bird.
I have a fascination for trees. And most of my photographs in my store are trees, bare branches and leafy and all that. I don't know why I have that fascination, but I think go there.
Do you know the work of Robert Adams?
No, I don't. No.
There's another reference for you to look at. Robert Adams is an American photographer. He's very concerned. His work is very environmentally concerned, and he works in black and white. But he photographs a lot of trees as well, not necessarily in terms of, you know, an idealized symbol of nature. But I recommend you take a look at his work as well.
Yeah, I will do.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to move on now to, that's if everybody's okay, I'll move on to... to Ed's work. I'll just make sure that my phone is on silent, actually. Thanks for reminding me. So this is Ed's work. And again, it's in response to last week's assignment. And does anybody... Would anybody like to comment or contribute, to give feedback to Ed on this work? Ed, are you here?
I am.
Great. I don't want to go first, because I'm the one who's always talking, but if anybody else would like to give some feedback.
I think it needs to be seen on a bigger scale. It's very hard to see what's there.
Yeah, that's a good piece of feedback. A good piece of feedback, Pascal, because... It often changes a piece of work seen on a screen, you know, especially if you're looking at it on a phone screen. I'm looking at it on quite a big screen, but even then, you know, it's something that, again, that a lot of photographers would explore in their work is size, and the size of the print. And it doesn't mean necessarily that big is better, but it's something to think about for sure.
There's a lot of detail in that one, so you have to see.
Yeah.
My first reaction to it was, we're inside, we're looking out, there's this whole world out there that we can't access at the moment.
Yeah.
And even having the blinds on the window is a further barrier. You know, it's indicative of the barriers that are there to people having, you know, freedom of movement at the moment.
Yeah, like they're like bars on the windows.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good piece of feedback too. Yeah, very good.
That's what I felt as well, a very similar view. Sorry, my battery's running low here.
Okay.
And I have actually, please excuse me if I disappear, I just have had somebody calling, an electrician.
No problem.
So I felt the very same thing, that it's viewing the outside world and behind closed...
Gone.
Can I just add something?
Go ahead, Tara. Yeah.
I just think this is what I really want. If you're in a room together, or it's easier, just be every single thing that's represented here is obviously very meaningful to you, Ed. Or that's the impression I'm getting. So yes. I'd like to go through all what's the significance of the 40th mug. Was that your 40th, if I'm reading that right? What's the significance of the streetscape? Who's Bobby Hanvey, etc.? So
yeah,
it's like all these clues.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I feel the same way. And as I look at it, the for me, I find it's the things that you've arranged around around the edge of the frame, for me, are interesting. They seem, for me, to direct my gaze into the middle and out the middle of the window, which is very interesting. It's very interesting. I find my eye just drawn to the center, and then I'm also aware of the things that are in the periphery. And maybe that's what you intended, that all of these things that we would consider part of normal life are now on the periphery, and the center is... the blocked or barred window. Before Ed speaks about the work, would anybody else like to say something? You don't have to, but feel free if you do. Ed, would you like to say a few words?
Sure, thank you. Thank you for all that feedback. It's it's very interesting. I see I'm not on camera, I guess.
We can see you.
Okay, thank you. I think some of it is actually quite correct as far as perspective is concerned. When I started on the assignment, I was sort of looking around my apartment, and one of the things that I noted was that I had a lot of artifacts, I guess you would call them, that sort of were connected to my professional career. And I think I'm still transitioning from a professional career to a retired life. Mm-hmm. And each of these things that I've collected over the course of my work career has, it's a very emotional connection for me, from, you know, the Korean theater mask, from working with a group of Korean students, from the marble ball, from a colleague boss who I once worked with many years ago, who's died way much too young, from a photograph that I bought from an exhibit in a library. And what I began to feel is that, you know, for home for me was a place that sort of merged together my outside life and my inside life. Things that I did in my professional life and my work life, I brought home and contributed to that home life, and that home life sort of extended outside to my work life. So it was a place where I was able to sort of synthesize, I guess, my identity. And the photograph in the middle is that's not where I live. That's across the street from where I live. Okay. But I'm sort of looking outside a window in my apartment, but also sort of looking, you know, almost you could say looking at another place to live too. So inside, outside. So those were the feelings that I had when I constructed this.
Yeah, it's very interesting. One of the things that we are going to talk about, or that we're going to mention today, is what this photograph makes us ask sometimes is, you know, what perspective are we seeing on things? Who, what are we looking at? What's our relationship to what's shown in the photograph as the viewer? So one of the things that we're going to mention today, and this photograph does it. So it's I really like it. Well done. So I'll just move on, because I'm just conscious of time as well. So this next piece is Pascal's response. Take a look at it, take a moment. And if anybody wants to jump in and comment.
To me, actually, that's a bit like a Martin Parr.
Mm.
In terms of the everyday, ordinary life.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a lovely room, and I'm jealous of how big you've grown that plant, because I can't get mine to grow that big. But it's just a slice of life.
Hmm. Hmm. And I can definitely see the influence of what we were looking at last week, which I mean that as a compliment. It's like you looked at the images that we looked at last week, and you've sort of absorbed them, Pascal. I think it's very interesting. Anybody else?
I'd also say Brian. Ed. I'm sorry.
Was that Ed?
Yes.
Go ahead there, Ed, yeah.
It just makes me wonder, is this clearly some arts and crafts work going on? Who's involved in that? It's a very neat arrangement. It makes me think maybe it's an adult doing some work there.
Yeah. Basically, it's obviously where I live, is my house, and we have a room dedicated to painting.
Mm.
And it's basically a messy table of brushes and water and paints and things. And what I was trying to do is not make it too obvious as to what it was. And then in the backyard, there is my husband on the lounger reading whatever. And what I was trying to do was say, can I make a narrative somewhere, somehow? So I'm not sure. See, that was my idea. I wanted a story, but I'm not sure I got it.
No, you did. You did. There's a narrative in that. When I looked at this first, Bridget sent it to me on email. I didn't look at it very long. I just glanced at it and I didn't spot the figure in the background. It wasn't until this morning when I looked at it a bit closer. It's almost impossible not to put a narrative into a photograph, in my opinion. You know, you will always see a narrative in an image. You'll always try and read it and wonder what the story is. So there's definitely a narrative there. The interesting thing, though, I think, is that it might not necessarily be the narrative. People will always they will always bring their own experience to the image, and they will always read it from their own cultural background, their own perspective. So it might not necessarily be your narrative that they read, but they will read a narrative in it. Okay?
Just something else I'd add quickly is, Pascal, I think what's interesting is that I sense a hesitancy in that photograph. So kind of interested that it's hanging back, whereas you'd normally be attracted to the sunlight where your husband is.
Mm.
So there's a hesitant, like somebody's hanging back. That's what it feels
He's almost hidden in the background.
Go
on, Pascal. Yeah, sorry.
No, I was wondering, would people even spot him in the background? And would they ask themselves a question, basically, about what is this photo about?
Yeah. So again,
Is it too obvious, basically?
No, I don't think it is. Again, you're thinking about, you're asking questions. You're making the viewer question, what is this image about, you know? Making them look at it and examine it to find the, if you like, the hidden treasure in the background. That's the way I'd see it anyway. And I think, I don't know whether that's a toilet roll in the foreground. That's what I saw. And I thought, sense of humor. That to me says something about the photographer. Robert Adams, I think, also said that every photographer or every photograph has an element of autobiography in it, you know, that you can't avoid putting yourself into the image.
I think it's a kitchen roll, not a toilet roll.
Yeah, it could be a kitchen roll. Looking at it here, it could be a kitchen roll. But when I looked at it first, I read toilet roll
first.
Yeah. And again, probably we read toilet roll initially because of the circumstances that we find. So there you go. We're bringing our own reading to work, influenced by what's going on around us right now. I saw a toilet roll this morning, but when I see it here on the screen, I see a kitchen roll. You know, so okay.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna move on. This is Miriam's. Is Miriam here?
Yeah.
Okay. So before you say a few words, Miriam, would anybody like to give Miriam some feedback on this?
It's lovely detail in the sky.
Yeah,
it's a lovely competition. Yeah, the reflections are amazing. Mm. And the contrast between the amber goldy colours and the, you know, of the sun, sunset, and the darkness of the landscape and the boats. It's great contrast.
Yeah. Lovely.
Yeah, it's very beautiful. I'm very jealous.
I'd say as well, there's many different layers to this, or in the sense of there's this gentle diagonal and zigzag going back and forth and back and forth with light, dark.
Yes.
So compositionally, that's very satisfying.
Mm.
You know, and they're almost parallel, you know, but not, because they're zigzagging. So the sense of perspective, that you're being led right out.
Yes.
To the sea, where the sun, as far as where the sun is.
Yes. That strong line leading you into the back of the picture.
Mm. Yeah.
And, something else I noticed about it is the way the mast subdivides the frame and the wall in the background with the horizon. You know, you've got a nice, the golden ratio there, you know. So, it's a very peaceful picture.
There's almost like, because sometimes with landscape, they're shot in landscape, but because this is portrait, I feel like we're very much, it's like a point of view of the boat, like we're almost in the position of this person who's going out to sea or something, you know. It's there's a I don't know, I feel like there's a kind of a journeyman quality to it or something.
But
the tide thing is that there's no water, so that boat is stuck.
The tide is out, but you know that will come back.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, so we have a metaphor.
The clouds are magnificent. They remind me of a shade that's just about pulled down to say the day is done, that it's all over for today.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. And it's interesting, the clouds are clearing. So we have a layer upon layer. As you said, Tara, it's a very layered image. There's lots of different meanings that you can see in it, you know? Miriam, would you like to say something about it before we move on? You don't have to, but feel free if you do.
Yeah, no problem. It's basically the current situation we find ourselves in and the limit that we had to take respite and take exercise over the last while until the 5K extension. Mm. We see every day, or we look every day, but we don't see.
Yeah.
Mm. And now we see things more clearly. The weather has been amazing with some freak of nature. And it just means that things will turn, but for the moment there is a lot to see and give sanctuary to the soul and the mind during these tough times. And it will come back.
Well done everybody for sharing the work. I also have a piece here, so go easy on me, okay, because I bruise easy. So,
are you losing your sense of self, Brian? Is that
it's related to something that we're going to talk about at the end. It's related to the final assignment. I won't say any more than that. If anybody feels they want to comment, go ahead.
Full of humor.
Is it a mask or a mask?
Is it sorry, I missed that.
I say, is it a mask you've made?
Yeah, you could say that. You could say that for sure, Michael. Yeah. Yeah.
The top of it blends into the screen at the back.
Yeah, that's a window. But it could be a screen. It could be a screen too. You could read it as a screen. For sure you could.
And what's in the, is it a paper and you have a line on it?
Yeah. Yeah, so I should say that I shot this on my phone, okay? So I think it's important that when I ask you guys to contribute and show your work that, you know, that I also do it. I could have obviously done it with a DSLR or any of the other cameras that I had and played around with it in Photoshop, but I decided to use my phone just to show that, you know, you can do an awful lot with your phone. You don't need any special equipment. I can't emphasize that enough, that, you know, you can make interesting work. You can play and make interesting photos with nothing more than a smartphone. Okay. And in terms of how I made it, I was just playing, messing around. The first couple of images I took, I deliberately left my face out of it. And then I got the idea to use a piece of paper, and, you know, it progressed from there, and I made a series. And so when you see it, something as well that you might also be fooled into thinking about a photographer's work is that, you know, the finished image, that they happened to be there at the right time, and that they were somehow endowed with some amazing superhuman sense of sight. And in fact, if you go and look at what are called contact sheets, you'll find that they watched the situation develop, or they were developing the situation themselves and photographing as they were working through something. And then they go back and pick the image afterwards. And that's what I done here. It's just a piece of paper. I drew a line on it. And it's related to something that we're going to talk about later on. I'm not going to go into it.
It reminds me of somebody that opened the bookcase to take something out and didn't close the door after
that. Yeah.
And the book, is that the book beside you on the settee?
Could be. Yeah, it could be. And then, you know, when you see a situation, so I'll tell you, when I was looking at this afterwards, for instance, you see my, it'd be, as we're looking at the left hand, but it's actually my right hand, I was thinking, that's interesting. I don't remember making that gesture, but, you know, you see different several photographers, including one we're going to talk about now, have talked about that life doesn't really exist until you see it photographed. You know, that there's a further interpretation available on life when you photograph it. So, okay.
What strikes me a lot about it are the lines in the photograph, because we don't have color to influence us. Yeah. There's so many vertical and horizontal lines,
yes,
from the bookcase to the books to the window to the, yes, curtain pole to the, you know, the sofa, even the lines on the cushions.
Yeah.
Cushion on the sofa and the lines on your jacket.
Yeah.
You know, and they're mainly straight lines.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, even the cushion behind you on the sofa, it's on a horizontal. You know, cushions, yeah, are often soft, yeah, and dumpy, whereas that strong vertical line,
yeah,
there behind you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, Mary.
Not aligned.
Anybody else before we move on?
I like that there's a lot of noise in the photograph.
Yeah. I have to confess that I added the grain afterwards, because it's to do with the same as a piece of paper. I'm obviously concealing something, which is my face. And I was thinking, you know, about how I often think a lot about how we assume that photographs tell us something about the world or show us something. And in fact, quite often they conceal an awful lot, which is, again, something that we're going to talk about some more. So I'm going to move on, guys, because I'm just conscious of time. Is everybody okay on time?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So I'm going to move on to talk about the first of all, the theme, okay? The theme this week is looking, gazing, staring, okay? Three different words, but all important when it comes to art and photography. So that's what we're going to be examining this week. And I thought I would start with a couple of quotes from different artists that emphasize the value or the importance of looking. So the first one is, I begin by not photographing, Jeff Wall. Jeff Wall is a contemporary photographer. He works in very large scale. I suppose a lot of people think that photography is about observing and capturing a moment, but a lot of contemporary photography has moved on beyond that. And it's really about directing and making something happen. And Jeff Wall's images are what you might call staged. It's a very crude term. It implies that they're not authentic, but they are, you know, there's this idea of authenticity. I think we've left it behind at this stage. For instance, if I was a painter and I painted a portrait of somebody, nobody would ask me if that was real. But if you introduce a camera into the equation, you get asked straight away, did you Photoshop that? Is that real? You know, and it's not really relevant when it comes to art, whether it's authentic or not. So Jeff Wall talked about how he finds the subjects for his work by not photographing. In other words, he collects them as he goes around in daily life. He's an observer, and they go into the brain and they go into the subconscious and they pop out in his work. So I thought that was apt to what we're going to talk about today. And then the second thing is on the gaze. This is Roland Barthes. If you don't know his work, I recommend, I'll do a reading list at the end, okay? At the end of all this, but Roland Barthes is a famous French critic, and photography was something that concerned him, and he wrote a lot about photography. So this is on the gaze. Science interprets the gaze in three combinable ways. In terms of information, the gaze informs. In terms of relation, gazes are exchanged. In terms of possession, by the gaze, I touch, I seize, I am seized. But the gaze seeks something, someone. It is an anxious sign, singular dynamics for a sign. Its power overflows it. I would like to emphasize one part of this. By the gaze, I touch, I seize, I am seized. Okay, I want you to keep that in mind as we go through this. Okay? Still with me?
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to move on to the first piece of work we're going to talk about this week. I've gone back, not forward. Hang on a sec. The first piece of work that we're going to talk about this week is a piece of work that was made in the late 60s and early 70s, I think, by Richard Avedon. If you don't know Richard Avedon's work, I recommend that you look him up. He's one of the most important photographers of the 20th century. He was started out in the army, actually, in the Merchant Marine, as a photographer's assistant in World War II in America, and he went on to work for Harper's Bazaar and Vogue and other places like that. Very well known for his groundbreaking, I suppose, for fashion photography, but also he was a very important portrait photographer. And this is a piece of work that he made in the late 60s and early 70s. I'm just going to read from a book just before we go on. I'll show you the first image, and while I'm reading, you can take a look at the first image, okay? Still with me?
Yep.
Okay. In the American West. Okay, in the late 1960s, Richard Avedon published a series of portraits in Rolling Stone magazine called The Family. Now, if you haven't seen that piece of work, look it up. It's very, very good. I saw it in Ireland a couple of years ago. It's a fantastic piece of work. The pictures were of powerful people, mostly men. The subjects were evenly lit by ambient light, without a hint of shadow, and were posed in Avedon's signature setting against the stark white backdrop paper. They seemed uneasy. Many of them were uncertain of what to do with their hands, some of them seeming to collapse inwards in on themselves, but nonetheless determined to face the camera. Looking at these portraits, one felt the silence, which had been an element in their making, as a tangible presence. It was rumoured that Avedon did not speak to his subjects while he was shooting. They were ushered into his studio by an assistant and told to line their feet with a mark on the floor. The camera, an imposing 8x10-inch view camera mounted on a tripod, had been focused in advance, using an assistant as a stand-in for the eventual subject. For the entire session, the photographer would walk around the room, tethered to the camera by a long cable lead, staring. After each exposure, an assistant would change the film holder and the staring would resume. The result was a series of portraits in which the subject's own presence were engulfed by the intensity of the photographer's gaze, which is why I emphasized the gaze earlier on. Sometimes the subject would stare back aggressively, but there would never be any doubt about who was in control. In a subsequent portrait project in the American West, an example of which is included here, Avedon used a similar procedure when he directed his camera towards ordinary people, drifters, miners, housewives, prison inmates, cowboys, itinerant people. They were carefully chosen for the way in which they represented the old frontier of America. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I've included, I'll just go forward and show you the ones that I've included. It's a big series. Okay, so there's this one. This one. This one. And this one. Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Would anybody like to comment?
Their eyes, to me, seem to be the main feature of the picture.
Yes.
I was drawn to their eyes.
Yeah. Do you find yourself staring at them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If they were in front of you in the flesh, would you stare at them so long?
No.
Mm-hmm. No.
There's aggression there and defiance as well, mm-hmm. some of them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And resignation, I think, in the previous one.
In this one, yeah. Yeah.
No, I think she's defiant looking.
Yeah.
You don't know whether she's an inmate of the jail or whether she works in the jail.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good observation, Rita.
Yeah.
What does the plain white background, how does the plain white background, think about how the plain white background affects the image. If he had shot this, say, you know, outside, or this one in whatever this person was working, or
concentrate your mind on the image anyway, you know, there's nothing in the background to distract you looking at it, nothing to draw you away from the image.
Yeah.
Very stark.
Stark, yeah. Stark is a good word.
Yeah.
Stark is a very good word.
Everything about them is defined.
Yes.
Every piece of hair and everything.
Yeah.
You cannot ignore any detail because it's all standing out.
Yeah. And I think that's a deliberate strategy by the photographer. He used, I think for all his work, he used the view camera, which is a large format camera. And it's almost forensic in the detail it can capture. And I think also, Pascal, it's also emphasized by, our attention is drawn to every detail by the back, by the white background.
Yeah, exactly.
Anything else? Anything else that you notice?
Well, I'm curious as to what the dress means, for because that seems to be an important component of each one of them. The prison photo, there are some hints there, but again,
I'm not sure. I found no mention of the clothes that they wear. I think it's their own clothes, so they chose what to wear. But I could be wrong about that. I did look around for some information, but yeah. And they were people that for Abedin represented the American West, you know. So this guy looks like a worker, maybe a mechanic, or there's coal miners. It's a big series. You can look it up. There's a book. I'll tell you.
They're a bit like characters from Of Mice and Men or something. He looks like.
Yes.
Yeah.
For sure.
They're all quite aggressive.
Yeah.
Except for the last girl in the bib.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
They look as if they resent being there.
Remember last week I showed you a photograph of a woman sitting in a chair. Somebody said it looked like she was in the waiting room. I don't know whether you remember. It doesn't matter. It's in last week's notes. That's actually a photograph that I took based on Avedon's supposed methodology here, which is to set up the camera and you tell the person not to speak and to just look at the camera, and you don't speak to them and you keep them there. So there's an element of that going on here as well, this sort of idea that, you know, that they would perform for the camera, that, you know, in other words, he had everything set up. So there was nothing to make him interrupt looking or staring at the subject. All he had to do was press the shutter when he thought that they had made a facial expression that interested him. So in a way, we're not really seeing the real person here. And I think that's one of the points. We never really see the real person in a portrait. And we see what the photographer wants us to see. Mm-hmm. He speaks of his work as opinions, that they're, you know, that they're not documents. They're not documentary, that they're his opinions.
But they are full of life. They have, and I wonder, you know, if he took our photos, like this group here, of us in the club. Yeah. I mean, is it because he's a brilliant photographer, or because he really chooses people of a lot of character and life on their face anyway? I mean, if he took a photo of us, anybody you see in the street,
well,
would you get that much character out of it, you know?
I can sort of answer that question in that I know that he chose these people on a preconceived idea.
Yeah.
So he chose them for something he saw in them. Maybe, you know, he started out with, there's another famous German photographer, August Sanders, who photographed people between the First World War and the Second World War, and he collected, he called them typologies or archetypes. And he collected, he deliberately photographed people depending on their trade or their professional qualification. And I would imagine that there's a certain amount of that going on here. So he's probably influenced by Sanders' work as well, because Sanders' work is very influential in terms of portraiture. So he chose coal miners, he chose drifters, he chose inmates from prisons, he chose, so he probably had a couple of different types of people he wanted to show, and then he, I would imagine that he went through whoever he screened, whoever he was going to photograph, and then they were submitted to the long stare and the, you know, no talking, and he just observed them, and then what we're getting is his his pick of the observations, I suppose.
Yeah.
So, but it makes interesting work, doesn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Brian, I'm also thinking that, you know, there's a whole mythology of the American West in the title of the series, and these are certainly not the kinds of portraits that would align with the mythology.
Yes. That is a very good observation, Ed, because if you Google this piece of work, and I recommend you do, you'll come across a lot of stuff that's written. And actually, mythology is a good word because, first of all, you'll come across, I think very few so far, I haven't been looking for very long, but you'll come across very little analysis of the work itself. You'll come across people who mythologize him and say that he was just a genius. And then you'll come across people who really object to the fact that these portraits don't meet the mythological standards of the American West. They didn't. There's one website, American Suburb X, I think that's it. I might include a link to that particular review, where the reviewer reacted viscerally against this work. He just didn't feel that it fit the required. It didn't fit with the mythology, and that's very important. Yeah. You know that, Ed, from because you're based in the States. But there's a very strong mythology of the American West and divine providence and so on and so on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
America really defines itself on the conquest of the West.
Yeah.
Anybody else? And then, of course, these are working class people. That's the other thing that's worth saying. They're working class people, all of them. Anybody else got anything to say? Okay. I just want to make a couple of observations myself and then we'll move on. So the couple of things that occurred to me when I looked at this work was the way the white background isolates the figure, okay? They look isolated to me against the plain background. Stark, somebody said stark earlier on. They've nowhere to hide. Subject is almost clinically examined. And Pascal, that to me is what you're, it chimes what you're saying about the detail. They're clinically examined in detail. We see them unadorned and exposed, which is, it's photography, they're exposed. We are invited to stare much longer than that's why I asked you, would you, if these people were in front of us, we would not stare at them this long. I think they've shown that the longest that you can stare before people feel uncomfortable is something like 13 seconds. Well, we've been talking and looking at this work for 5 to 10 minutes now, and looking at this work. So we're being invited to stare here. Avedon has... The photographer's gaze has taken possession of these people, and now they're given to us for us to possess and care and stare at and really look at. Okay?
But they're also all very attractive in their own way.
They are not
average looking,
They
all are, even this guy here.
Yeah.
Attractive in his own way,
Yeah.
He looks very menacing.
Yeah.
A bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, the thing never judged the book by the cover, but he actually does look menacing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So does he.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's interesting to me that most of the portraits that I see in books from this series and also from online, they tend to be the men, and I've deliberately put in, because he didn't just photograph, it's easy to come away with the impression that all he photographed was men, but he included the women of the American West as well, and children. There's children in it too. I'm just going to move on. And again, we're talking about looking. So the second image that we're going to look at is also an image that invites us to look. And it's this image here by Juliet Margaret Cameron. It's called A Kiss of Peace, made in 1867. I'll just say something about a few things about Juliet Margaret Cameron. She was one of the first women to be taken serious women photographers to be taken serious as an artist. She came to photography quite late, and she photographed. She was well connected in terms of artists and writers in Victorian England, and she spent her life. She photographed a lot of the intelligentsia, if you like. Again, a bit like Avedon, she spoke about, She spoke about trying to capture the person underneath with her work. And now whether that's possible or not is debatable. I think that's up for me, that would be up for interpretation. But she's making pieces that she would regard as opinion rather than documents, you know, or statements of fact. So I'm just going to, again, read from this book. It will be on the reading list, so don't fret. I'll make sure that everybody has this book. I highly recommend it. It's called Train Your Gaze by Roswell Anger. So let's take a basic event of looking a step further. Consider these two photographs, this one and the next one. We'll get to the next one in a minute. This is by Julia Margaret Cameron. The second one is by Cindy Sherman, which you've seen before. They are pictures, they are actually pictures about looking. In the Cameron image, The Kiss of Peace, we see a woman and a girl, presumably mother and daughter. As is the case with Avedon's pictures, with their assertively blank backdrops, there is no suggestion of location or context here. The subjects inhabit an undisclosed space. There are no historical markers. The figures are dressed in a way that belongs to no particular time. We are asked to read this image in terms of bare essentials. Who is there? What are they doing? What is being exchanged between the two figures, the woman and the girl? And where do we, as the viewer, fit into the scene? And that kind of links back to your image, Ed, and looking at the window. Where do we fit in as the viewer, fit into this scenario? The look of these, are you still with me?
Yep.
The look of these two figures by themselves suggests a Victorian cultural value. Female modesty coded as an inverted gaze. Mother and daughter show us their profiles. They do not confront us, and they do not confront each other, unlike the last piece of work where the viewer is confronting us. The daughter's eyes flow politely downwards in the general direction of her mother's breast, but the mother's gaze provides something of a surprise. If you do not look too carefully, we might get the impression that her attention is focused completely on her daughter, but this is not the case. Her left eye is directed outwards, towards, but not at us, the viewers. The mother's outward gaze includes us. The direction of her looking suggests an attitude of cautious interception. She is aware of our presence. She is ready to defend or protect this awareness. The maternal overview is superimposed on the intimate moment represented inside the frame. It is as if she's attempting to leech her attention away from her daughter and so interrupt the process of her own looking. Any comments? No rush.
I just see the Madonna and Child there the minute I saw it.
That's a very good observation, Michael. Yeah. That is a very good observation.
It's quite a religious feel about it.
Yeah. That is a very, very good observation. And I'll get to why in a few minutes.
Normally the Madonna child is a baby boy.
It's a feeling of sadness about the photo. Both their mouths seem to be downturned.
Yes, Marie. Anybody else? Okay.
I don't know whether it's relevant or not, but both of them, the mother and the child, both of them, their hairs are very untidy.
It is relevant. I, there's no right or wrong interpretation to any of this. It's interpretation. So, again, that's a good observation.
If they were posing for the picture, you think they would have actually tidied their hair or something. But they are posing.
They are posing, yes. And that's a good observation. That's a very good observation that, you would expect that if it was posing, if they were deliberately posing, that they would set themselves up. But I don't think that's what Cameron was after. She was trying to show, intimate. You know, if it's an intimate portrait, you wouldn't expect people to be... all in their best bib and tucker and, hair made up and, Like, so that would be more, that's a very good observation. But if they were in their best clothes, in with their hair done up and their you know, their nails, and so that would be more like presenting yourself to the camera, being prepared. It's you know, sort of like putting on your war paint or putting on your face before you step in front of the camera. So what
I would imagine here, I would imagine that they were poor.
Yeah.
They weren't high quality. You know, they weren't people of quality.
Yeah. Yeah.
They look kind of poor people.
Yeah. So can I make an observation about something that we talked about last week about show, don't tell, and, you know, try and think about what you show and what you don't show. So here we're not being shown a lot of information. We're not being given a lot of clues. It's almost like a blank canvas. So, you know, if you present a viewer with a blank canvas, there are a lot of things that you can put on that canvas. You can bring a lot of your own personal interpretation to a piece of work.
The mother looks like a painting. Like, yeah. She looks like she was painted.
Yeah.
But the daughter definitely makes it look like it's a photograph. But the mother has this beautiful face.
Mm.
And she could even be, you know, like a painting or a very delicate sculpture or something.
Yeah. Yeah. I just conscious of time. I just want to read this last piece on this, and then we're going to move on. Okay. And it's very relevant to what Michael said about the Madonna. As a title, The Kiss of Peace is a modest description, or is a modest deception, perhaps a piece of camouflage that we are meant to see through. And that is very related to, was it Miriam who mentioned about their social status, the poor, and again, you know, that kind of idea. There's a bit of deception going on here, but there's a lot we're not being shown. Cameron, who was one of the first photographers to be taken seriously as an artist, has insinuated a commentary on a cultural stereotype while pretending to simply render it. The stereotype is that of the docile Madonna, ever available to the leisurely inspections of our viewers' gaze. If it is possible to see an attitude of resignation in the mother's expression and even in the tilt of her head, it could be read as a sign of the immense effort involved in maintaining this masquerade. Okay? Still with me?
Yeah.
Make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Before we move on, does anybody want to contribute anything else? Okay. So the second piece of work, we looked at this before, I think, Cindy Sherman, Untitled Film Still number 3. I'm going to read you out something here as you're viewing it. And then we're going to move on to this week's assignment, which is a two-part assignment. Cindy Sherman's work might at first seem less than compatible with Cameron's, implies similar strategies in her pictures. Note the word strategies. Everything is deliberate. She is concerned with the spectacle of female identity and issues of femininity in a way that is more overt and thorough than in the case with Cameron. Untitled Film Still number 3 is part of a portrait series in which the artist herself impersonates various archetypes of femininity. Many of the images depict situations that derive from 1950s film noir narratives, movies that deal with sexual triangles, typically centered on a designing woman who is looking for a way out of an oppressive or abusive relationship. This image presents us with a woman in a tight top standing in a kitchen sink. There is a suggestion of dirty dishes. A sharply focused bottle of detergent intersects the out-of-focus handle of a pot that juts into the frame like an arrow, pointed directly at the woman's upraised left breast. The woman's gaze is directed out of the frame. The implication is that she is looking towards someone else in the room, out of the camera's field of view, possibly at her husband stroke captor. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot more to read, but I don't think I'm going to read it all.
Okay.
So I'll pass it over to you guys if you want to say anything.
That's fine.
What I'm trying to get across to you here is that it's there's a lot of work, and a lot of work goes on before you even pick up the camera. That might feel like a lot for you right now, but there's a lot of deliberation, a lot of thinking goes on about what you're trying to say, and what would it mean if I did this. And you can do that as you're making the work as well, of course. And you can interpret your own work. You can photograph, look at it, think about what does it say, what's going on here, what does it mean if I make this gesture, what does it mean if I make that gesture. One of my tutors said, you are your own audience. You are your own first audience. Okay?
Okay.
Still with me?
Yeah.
Yep.
How do you think this one compares to the last image?
Well, this one is very much, to me, it's staged.
Yeah.
And the difference in the modern face and the eyes are done.
Yeah.
Her eyebrows are shaped.
Yeah. That's interesting because they're both, you know, they're both staged.
Yeah. But I think this one is more intriguing in that there could be loads of stories there we don't know.
Mm.
The way she looks, is she defensive?
Mm. This gesture would have.
She has her hand on her tummy. Mm. You know, you don't quite know what. Does she want to be there? Does she not?
Mm.
Was she taking? Was her photo taken against her agreement? Or I don't know.
Yeah, even the way she holds her shoulder up, I think, is really interesting.
Yeah, it's defensive. Yeah.
Hmm. Hmm.
It's claustrophobic, isn't it? That would seem.
Yes. Yes. And do you notice? You might be aware of it. You might not. You see the pot handle on the left.
Yeah.
It's like a line drawing our attention to her. You know, your eye sort of moves around the picture, but when you find the pot handle, you're directed back to look at her, and it's looking at her body really, rather than her face. Is actually almost the top of her head is cropped out.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, true.
Hello?
Hey, Brendan, I can hear you. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just going to say, the whole thing is, she's no domestic Debbie. You know, she's doing the dishes, but she just seems like she shouldn't be there.
Yes.
Her apron is made of silk. And if you can see, it's complete see-through apron. Yeah, I can see the follow-up line going through there from the dress. Like, who wears a silk apron, right?
Yes.
And her eyes, and I come hit her eyes.
Yes.
She looks like she's wearing a wig, actually, as well. I don't know. Very sultry.
She probably is wearing a wig. But you've hit the nail on the head there. You've definitely, there's an incongruency between the way she's dressed and what she's doing.
Exactly,
Because the place is actually very ordinary. There's nothing glamorous about the place at all.
Yeah.
And very confined.
Yeah.
And she's trying to dress up for the photo. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a very good observation, Pascal and Brendan. Both of them are very good observations. It's amazing. What I find really interesting about all of this work is that the longer you look at it, there's more to extract from it. Every time you come back to it, you see something that you hadn't seen before, which is, again, we're back to looking.
Where was this picture taken?
These are all, Cindy Sherman created, she's a performance artist. She's still making work. You'll find her on Instagram.
It's like the 60s film.
They're all inspired by film noir or B films in the 60s, American films. She was very much interested in or exploring the way women were portrayed in Hollywood, and probably more than Hollywood, in the 60s and 70s. So these are kind of female archetypes, you know, they're typical roles that women would have been given to play. As it said in the text there, the designing woman looking to get out of a relationship that was maybe not working out or that might have been abusive.
Mm.
So she's really playing off that. And you know, there's still women artists making work like that, interesting work. You know, have you ever noticed in a lot of crime, both books and on the TV, you know, that it's mostly women who are the murder victims. And I think even in real life, statistically speaking, you know, it's mostly the men who are the perpetrators, but, you know, women are continuously given that role, I suppose. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
He actually looks the way I feel sometimes when I find the sink dirty, you know, that the man in the house hasn't bothered his backside cleaning it.
Yeah. I think the dirty dishes are significant as well.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah.
And I think there's a fair amount of branding going on there, the salt and the detergent and, you know, up on the shelf there. To me, it says, like, this is pretty standard.
Yes, and I think that's important too. It's an everyday setting.
Yeah.
And also, Sure. It looks like she resents something to even to do cleaning up. It looks like it could be beneath her, kind of.
Possibly. Right.
Or she resents it.
She seems to resent having to be at the sink and having to do cleaning.
Yeah. One of the things that I find very interesting is who she looking at. You know, who's she looking at, and what's that facial expression about? You know, it's very interesting.
Dishes.
Huh?
You can do your own dishes.
You mean you can buy a dishwasher?
Yeah.
It's only a little kitchen. She hadn't got room for a dishwasher.
Okay, just again, conscious of time, so I'm just going to move on. So this week I'm going to ask you, it's a two-part assignment, and the first part is very simple, okay? So I'm just going to move on to this week's. Before I do, does anybody else want to say anything or contribute anything on them that we've looked at already?
No, thanks.
Okay, I'm going to take this as a no. Go on, yeah. Sorry, Ed, did you want to say something?
No, I'm good. Okay.
So, because we're talking about looking, this week's assignment, part one. This is a quote from a famous American photographer. Stare. It is the way to educate your eye and more. Stare, pry, listen, eavesdrop. Die knowing something. Walker Evans. Okay? I want you, as you're out and about, and again, the artist Jeff Wall, while speaking about how he made his images, said, I begin by not photographing. I've included the video where he's interviewed. Don't worry, Brendan, you're going to get this in by email, so don't worry.
Oh, great.
And it's to emphasize, I think we've been given a unique opportunity here. You can't go anywhere. You can't, you know, everything has stopped. This is the chance to down tools and spend time every day paying attention, looking around you. So I was saying to Tara and Bridget there before you came on to the call that I've been consciously trying to do this, and I've noticed things that I hadn't noticed before. You know, little details in the house, like the way the light comes in and hits a wall at different times of the year. Things in the house that I never noticed before. They've been there for years, but, you know, never noticed this, never noticed that. Something else, when I was sending this, I was thinking, you see that eavesdrop? Is everybody familiar with Maeve Binchy?
Yeah.
And Maeve Binchy said that she got a lot of her best ideas from her books by sitting in cafes and earwigging, listening to people. Okay? So this week, as you go about your daily life, for your first assignment is to take time out each day to look, stare, pry, and eavesdrop. Look for something you've never noticed before. Maybe something in your home, right in front of you, but you've never paid attention to it. Maybe something outside the home, in the street, in the supermarket. A snippet of conversation, the way people interact, the expression on someone's face, the way the light changes as it comes through a window. Make a note of these moments. Use a notebook. Use your phone. Record it or write your thoughts on whatever you have to hand. Bring them with you next week and share them. Okay?
Okay.
Okay. That's where every artist starts, whether you're a photographer or a painter. You start by looking around you, noticing. Okay, so you can spend all the, you can waste all your money on photography gear, but if you don't do that, you're just not going to make any interesting work. Okay, first part.
Thanks, Can I just say I don't have a ticket for next week, so how will I still get the code?
Bridget, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, anybody who's come previously can come along. I'll, Brian, if you want to set up, I don't know about...
Yeah, I'll set up a separate meeting. I won't make the same mistake again.
Yeah, yeah. If you set up the link, and then what I'll do is I'll send it to everyone who's come previously, and then obviously we'll have the people who booked in as well. You know, there's a drop-off rate for all, you know, for anything.
Yeah.
So I think it'll be fine.
Yeah.
The numbers and stuff like that, yeah.
Yeah. So don't worry about it, Miriam. That was Miriam, wasn't it? Because I can't see everybody's face.
It was Rita.
Rita. Okay. Second part of your assignment. The first week we talked about self-portraiture. Okay, I'm going to bring it up a notch now. Okay. So I'm going to show you a piece of work very quickly. You can come back and look at this later. You're going to get this tomorrow. And the piece of work is called The Storyville Portraits by E.J. Belloc. I can't pronounce that. In the early years of the 20th century, the commercial photographer E.J. Belloc made a series of strangely personal images in Storyville, the red light district of New Orleans. Many years later, the glass plate negatives were discovered and printed by photographer Lee Friedlander, who we talked about in the first week. According to the accounts of jazz musicians and photographers who knew him, Belloc was a difficult person, but he must have appealed to the inhabitants of the brothels who collaborated with him on a series of intimate, revealing portraits that are anything but pornographic in effect. In many of Belloc's images, the identity is hidden, either by a mask or by purposeful damage to the negative. It is unknown whether the defacement was done by the photographer or by the women he photographed. And you've got a link there to where that quote came from. And underneath here, you have a link to, you can see the full book. There's a PDF of the book that was made with these images online. And you can download the PDF if you want to. Or you can just Google and search for them. I've got a few examples here to show you. At first, it was thought that the plates were just damaged by water. They were left in his studio, I think, and water got in. And at first, it was assumed that the damage to the emulsion on the plates was by water, and then it was assumed that that wasn't the case, and that his brother, who was a Jesuit priest, had been so shocked by the subject matter that he'd done it. But subsequently, tests revealed that they could have only been done shortly after they were made, while the plates were still wet. So these are three, again, there's 89 different portraits. They're not all like this, but here's the first one. Third one. Okay. And you're probably asking yourself how this relates to your second part of the assignment. Don't worry, you don't have to get them. It's like that. Part two, for this assignment, you're to make a portrait of yourself, but you cannot show your face. This may be challenging because it is counterintuitive and goes against the grain of what you would do if asked to make a self-portrait. Think carefully. What does it mean to show yourself from below the neck only, from behind or as a shadow? To show only an isolated body part. Reflect on the phrase to lose face, also the word defaced. If your face is missing are you devalued or diminished? Bring your thoughts along next week and share them. Submit your images so we can discuss them. Can I emphasize before, I'm going to open it up if you want to say something now. Can I emphasize that the images are the images. You know, whatever you produce, you produce. Don't worry about whether it's good, whether you think it's good, whether it's not. Send in the images. What I really want to talk about here is what happens if your face is missing. How does it feel to photograph yourself and not include your face? Or, you know, if you just photograph an isolated body part, is it still you? They're the things I want you to reflect on. I want you to reflect on them as you're making the work. Mm. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and the reason why I'm interested in this is that it's something I'm interested in myself, which is related to the piece of work that I showed at the beginning. I started to think about portraiture and the face, and if you like, the way your face is a form of currency, okay? The way your face, all the things that you need your face to do, like have a social media account, your profile picture. To drive a car, you have to submit a portrait picture of yourself to have a driving license, to have a passport. But what happens if you take away your face? And also as well, there's a whole interesting discussion going on now in contemporary photography around big data and the internet and data theft, I suppose. There's a piece of work I just came across when I was preparing for this, which is, I'll show it next week, which is about the way different social media apps use your face, your profile picture as currency. And different companies are involved in selling on those identities. The profile pictures, the age, the sex, the and so on and so on. Your identity is a form of currency now online. And also facial recognition. A few years ago, there was a controversy on Facebook about facial recognition. They were sued because they started automatically, they used an algorithm to tag people in their photographs. And they settled out of court, I think, in 2016. So, and I'm not saying that to make anybody paranoid. It's an ongoing contemporary conversation related to portraiture, the face, and so on and so on. Okay.
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 Would anybody like to say anything before I wrap up?
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Brendan. Thanks for coming along. Please come next week.
I will.
Brian, did you take that picture? Was your phone on a tripod?
No, I just propped it up against some books. Oh. On a windowsill, propped up against a couple of books.
Okay.
Again, I'd say again, because I really want to emphasize that you can make interesting work with just your phone. You know, you don't need to. The camera industry is invested in you needing to spend your money. It, you know, it fools you into thinking that in order to make interesting work, you need to spend money on this lens, this camera, this tripod, this. And I'm speaking from personal experience because I've wasted a lot of money. It's very rare that the piece of equipment, in fact, it's more than very rare. It's just not true. You know, you can buy a better camera, but you won't take any better photographs. So you can make interesting images with very little, with no equipment, with just your phone. Okay.
Good. Okay.
And even I just one other thing, Rita. I said I added the grain. I did add the grain on the computer here, but even now you can buy an app for your phone. Like you can buy Photoshop, for instance, for your phone, and you can
add Photoshop.
You can add that grain yourself on your phone or your tablet. So the imaging equipment that all of you have at your disposal is good enough to do anything.
Mm.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. So I need to wrap up. Now, if that's okay with everybody, and I'll start by saying thanks very much for coming along and listening to me. I hope you found it enjoyable, and I'm really looking forward to seeing how you get on. And it's not about, I'm not interested in, there's no right or wrong, as I said somewhere along the way, there's no right or wrong response to any of these assignments. Just respond to it as you know. And please send in your work, bring along your observations, enjoy staring, enjoy prying, enjoy eavesdropping. Come along next week with something that you didn't know was there. I'd love to hear your stories. And then just finally, I need to just finish off again by thanking Bridget and Tara and Age&Opportunity for giving me the opportunity to do this. And I'd like to thank the sponsors again, which are Age&Opportunity, the Bealtaine Festival, the Bealtaine Festival at Home. And there's lots of interesting other activities that you can do. You can check out the website. I'll add the website address in here. Bridget, do you know the website address off the top of your head?
So it's bealtaine.ie.
Bealtaine.ie. There's lots of other things going on that you can tap into from home. The sponsors, the HSE, Age&Opportunity, Creative Ireland, and the Arts Council. Have I got them all?
Yep, that's it. Yep. Thanks, Brian.
Okay. Thanks, Brian.
Thanks, everybody.
Okay. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
next
week. Tara, I'll hang on now if you want to speak for a few minutes. Where's Tara gone?
Welcome, boy.
Is Tara, I'll come out of the screen, hang on, because I can't see. Stop sharing. Okay. Okay. Thanks, guys. Bye bye.
Bye bye. Thanks, Brian.
I'm just going to end the call. Okay. See you all next week. Look forward to it.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.